I've been redeemed.
I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
Say it again, say his blood.
His blood still works, and I'm glad to be.
Yes, I am. To testify, God is not dead, he's still alive. The same blood that was shed way back at Calvary is the same blood that's working now for me. Oh, his blood redeems me from the stain of sin, and his blood cleanses me deep down within. So if you ask me how I made it and how I've overcome, I can tell you it's because of the blood.
His blood still works, and I'm glad to report that it.
Never lost his power, and it never
yes.
will.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm redeemed, and it's by the blood of the Lamb.
Ah, glory to God. Thank you for the blood. How many of you know about the blood today? Glory to God. And it's all the blood, all the blood, all the blood, all the blood of Jesus. Yes, it does.
Greetings, brothers and sisters. That was only about 10% of you. Greetings, brothers and sisters.
Greetings.
Amen. Amen. Are you glad to be here?
Yes.
You glad to be alive?
Yes.
All is well?
Yes.
It is well with your soul?
Yes.
You're at peace with one another?
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
We're at peace with God. Amen. Are we here to worship the Lord?
Yes.
Amen. Praise God. So many of our worship services, you know, so many of our worship services and how they go, and I don't know if you thought about this, but it really, really depends to a large degree on how your week has been and whether or not you're prepared to put the week aside and just to say, Lord, these next few hours, I'm going to focus on you. So no matter what week you've had, whether it's been good, middle, or average, or bad, whatever it is, we are here today to worship God and to give him all the praise. Is that right?
Yes.
So that means that we are in charge. Amen.
Charge.
There is no devil in hell that can stop us from praising God if we want to. Is that right? Amen.
Taste and see how the Lord is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Oh, taste and see how the Lord is good, and his mercy endureth forever.
grace. Hallelujah. Praise God. You know, I was singing that song and it's true. God's mercies are new. They're never the same. They are never the same. We need a new touch from God every day. Every day. Every day. You know, every time you drive your car, your petrol gear goes down a little bit. It drains away. It drains away. And we go to the petrol station to what? What do? Top it up. And that's what we're doing today. We're getting topped up, but by God. Amen. We're going to sing this song. It's called The Anthem. All those that know it, say hi. Oh, Lord, I'm in trouble. Right, we're going to sing those. Get the words up on the screen, please. I'm sure Paulette knows it. We're going to sing. I'll sing it first. The keyboard will start. And then Brother Trevor will come and sing a solo. And then we'll join in together. You'll catch on. It's very simple, okay? You with me?
Yes.
You're going to support me?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. You've got to sing anyway, because you're singing unto God, not unto me. By myself. Okay.
Him somebody. And because he is a risen king, we sing, bless the Lord, oh my soul,
and all,
hallelujah,
that is within me, bless his holy name.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and and bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me, bless me, Lord. Lift your voices, lift your voices. Feeling down, bless the Lord, bless the Lord.
I will bless the Lord, all my soul, and all that is within me, bless me, Lord.
One more time. One more time. I will bless the Lord.
Hallelujah. The psalmist says, I will bless the Lord. He didn't tell us what condition he was in. He didn't tell us how he was feeling when he wrote the song. I don't know whether he was happy or sad, but he said, I will bless the Lord, oh my soul, for he has done great things. Run, come to the altar. Run, come to the altar real quick. We're going to pray. Run, come to the altar real quick. We're going to pray. We're going to pray. Don't know if Brother Glendon's in the house. Are you in the house, Brother Glendon? Can't see him. We're going to pray. And we're going to bless the Lord at the altar. Amen. I love this. I love it where we could rush up on God like this. I love it that we're a free church and we could do what we want to do. I love it that we don't have a priest ordering us around and telling us when to stop and when to praise him and when to holler his name, when to stand, when to glorify him. But we have this ability to praise God. I'm going to ask you, because there's no prescriptive way other than that we praise him with clean up, I'm going to ask everybody to go to God in prayer. Some of you might want to just tell him thank you. Some of you might want to say, God, how did I get through this last week? Some of you might want to pray for your mom and dad, but we're coming to God and we're saying, God, I will bless the Lord, for you have done great things. In the midst of our prayer, I want you to remember Brother Glendon's uncle who has been rushed into hospital. Got the message this morning. Please put him before the Lord in prayer. Come on, saints, by faith, let's go to the Lord in prayer now. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. Hallelujah. I hear a shout in the house. It's okay. So go ahead and shout for your God. Thank you, Lord, for waking us up this morning, Father God. Thank you, Jesus, for giving us life. Thank you, Lord God, for your grace and your favor. Thank you for your mercy that covers us new day by day, the mercies of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for my friends who are here today to worship and adore your name. Thank you for all that you have brought the people through. I thank God for the children, the young people who are at the altar. Lord God, they have their own issues to deal with. Lord God, you don't have to be grown up to have issues, Lord God, but they're here because they know how to pray and they want to pray and they want to say thank you. And I want to lead them this morning, God, in saying thank you. I want to lead the people, Lord God, in saying, God, we praise you. God, we adore you. God, we honor and glorify your name. I want to thank you, Father. I want to thank you for every stone that you overturned this week. I want to thank you for every pain you're fixing. I want to thank you for every injury in the body, Lord, that you're taking care of. I want to thank you for the various levels of faith, dear Lord, that have brought people into the house of God today. I want to acknowledge that there are people at the altar who have problems, but they have promised to bless the Lord at all times. Oh God, they have said that their praises will continue to be in their mouths. I pray that as we worship you today, our worship will become like an anthem, dear Lord. I pray that our worship would fill up every place where you are. I pray, mighty God in heaven, that as we worship you, dear Lord, the blessings of the Holy Ghost, the power of God will begin to fall at the altar in no prescribed way. Do what you want to do, God. We are giving up trying to run church. We can't run anything. Father God, move on your people as you want to. Move on your people as you see fit, oh God. Lift your people's faith today, Lord, as we pray. We bring Brother Glendon's uncle before you who's not well. We lift him up before you, God, and ask you, dear Lord, to heal his body wherever he is. I hope he's not worried. I hope he's not afraid. I don't know who he is. I don't know his measure of faith, oh God, but I pray if he's saved, oh God, that he will know to look up to you, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, that he will look up to you, who is a healer of his body. He will look up to you, hallelujah, as the great physician. If he's not saved, dear Lord, mighty God of Daniel, I pray in the name of Jesus that an angel would visit him and speak to his heart right now and touch his heart right now and convince him, dear Lord, of the need to recognize who he is in relationship to you. If he is not saved, touch him, God. Oh, God, remember him wherever he is right now. All those who are unwell, all those who are sick, all those who are troubled, Father God, may your glory rest upon each of us, Lord God, and give us your peace. Thank you, O God, for the voices. Lord, I know that if this sounds good to me, how must it sound to you in glory? Oh, hallelujah. And if you multiply this across the entire globe, the praises that are going up to you right now, Father God, how can you not move? How will you not move? How will you not do something extraordinary as we praise you? Oh, we are determined to praise you. We're determined to praise you, Lord, because you're a good God and your mercy endures to all generations. We thank you now. We praise you now. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Lord. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. As you go back to your seat, just continue worship. We haven't stopped anything. We're still worshiping. Amen. That's beautiful, saints. This is beautiful, saints. This is beautiful. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I'm aware that the time is just running away real fast. I'm going to ask those who are going to receive the morning tithes and offerings just to come and stand at the front, and we're going to ask the praise worship team and lead us in song as we worship the Lord in giving. Is that all right? Amen. We worship the Lord in giving. Ushers, would you come, please? Come right away. Don't delay. Come. And I'll leave it to the worship team as we come.
So I'm going to sing his call over all the earth. Get the words on the screen.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Just go ahead and lift your voices. He's waiting for you. Thank you, Lord. Worship you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We honor you, Lord. Honor you, Holy Spirit of the living God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I want us just to stand and respond one more time, this time, and ask you just to lift your hands, and for the next minute, just say something to him. Just say something to him. Just honor him now, just for the next minute. That's it, saints. That's it. That's all he wants to hear. Hallelujah. 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 God, we praise you. God, we praise you. God, we praise you. Jesus, we praise you. Thank you, Lord. Worship belongs to you, Father. Praise the name of the living God. Woo. Glory be to God. Amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We surrender, God, to you.
I surrender all.
You have to bear with me this morning, saints.
I surrender.
One more time. Withholding nothing, withholding nothing.
Oh,
go ahead and give him thanks. Hallelujah. Give him thanks. Give him thanks. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the living God. Hands together for Jesus. For Jesus. Today. Please be seated in his presence. Amen. Amen. When he visits us, we stop what we're doing. We divert from our agenda and we give him praise. Amen. God bless you. Bless you today. Well, it's difficult to know where to go, but let me just do what I have to do. And if he should interrupt the proceedings again, then that's perfectly all right with me. Amen. Praise the Lord. Glory be to God. I'd like you to turn your tablets, your iPads, whatever you have, to the book of John, chapter 8. And I'm going to invite you to stand for the reading of the word of the Lord. John chapter 8, reading from verses 1 to 11. As soon as you find it, say amen and stand with me. Let us read together. Hopefully it can be on the screen. If it's not on the screen, I'll continue to read. Thank you so much. We're looking at the King James Version. Okay. Praise the Lord. Jesus went, let's read from the screen together. 1, 2, 3, let's read. Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came again into the temple, and all the people came unto him, and he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery, and when they had set her in the midst, they say unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned, but what sayest thou? This they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground, as though he heard them not. So when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even until the last. And Jesus was left alone, and a woman standing in the midst. And when Jesus had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, He said unto her, Woman, where are thy accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? She said, No man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Then spake Jesus unto them again, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. We'll end it. Let's say amen to the reading of God's holy word. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Praise the Lord. I bring you all greetings in the name of the Lord. I want to continue on the theme growth, but today I want to attach it to, if I was to put a title to the sermon, to the message, it would be growth through mercy and truth. Amen. Growth through mercy and truth. Amen. Would you say that with me just to let me know that you're here? Growth through mercy and truth. Amen. When we think about the character of God, there are lots of different words that come to mind. Words like omnipotence. That is one of his characteristics. Is that right? Omnipotence, what does that mean? It means is God is often described as all-powerful. He is possessing unlimited or infinite power. Amen. He's omnipotent. He has all power. Another of his characteristics is that he is omniscient. We read this and we consider that God is everywhere. Amen. He's everywhere at all times, and there's nothing that he's not aware of. He knows everything. You can't trip God up. You can't trick him. There's no magician on the face of this earth that can play with God, because he knows all things. Number three, out of many, he is eternal. He is existing outside of himself, he outside of time and being uncreated. God has no father. He has no mother. He wasn't in anybody's belly for 9 months. He is God. There is no beginning. There's no end. There's no little sideway or back to front. He is just God. Always has been, always will be. Another of his characteristics is that he is just. Everything God does is just. Whether we see, whether we think it's unjust or not, he is just. He has to be just because justice is who he is. And he will always give us, because, and get this, brothers and sisters, because he is just, he will always give us what we deserve. Oh, let that sink in. I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, God will always, ultimately, give you what you deserve. But there is another characteristic of God that is so vital, and we've all experienced it as human beings. It is the characteristics of God's mercy. I thought I'd have a hand in the air there. Anybody in here, God has been merciful to you? Amen. I'm going to share with you today just a couple of definitions around this word mercy before I go deeper into the text. Firstly, we have a generic or a general understanding of this word mercy through a traditional meaning of the understanding of the word that we have. Mercy is that human behavior, that compassionate and forgiving attitude or disposition towards somebody who is in a position of vulnerability, a person who may be suffering, and so we, as much as we're able to, we have mercy on that person. How what does that look like? It may be that you're walking down the streets of Sheffield and you see somebody with a disease or somebody by the roadside, a poor man, a beggar, or whatever, and you might want to show mercy, and you might just want to put your hand in your pocket or buy them a sandwich or something. We all know how to show mercy, is that right? Yes, we do. But there's also a different type of mercy whereby somebody shows leniency towards somebody. So, for instance, I could be and let me bring my grandson into it so I can shame him up in front of everybody. I put him to bed last night, kissed him goodnight, but I made the mistake of leaving the tablet in the room, the iPad in the room. Now, I thought he'd gone to bed, but I woke up at 6 o'clock in the morning, and I saw a light in the bedroom. I said, Mr. Weird. When I went in, the tablet was on, playing away. 5:30, 6 o'clock in the morning, when he should be sleeping. I said, River, give me the tablet. I could have been stricter. I could have removed the whole tablet from usage. I could have given him a real mouthful. In my day, you would have got a good thrashing, a good beating. How many of you know what I'm talking about? But I took the iPad. I said, boy, go to your bed. This morning, he couldn't wake up. We know how to show mercy, don't we? Amen. But there's another type of mercy which we look at through the lens of Scripture, where we see that Jesus Christ, because he was so merciful, went to Golgotha, went to a cross, permitted those who couldn't really touch him, if they didn't want them to put him on the cross, drive nails in his hands and in his feet, and hang him there for the world to see. But by doing that, he was showing mercy to us, because now we can come to him for forgiveness of our sins. Are you with me? So many different aspects of mercy. But whatever aspect you look at, we are looking at a situation where somebody, he is guilty. In our case, it was us. Sinners guilty of hell and damnation. But we have around a Savior who has a choice whether to forgive us or not, and to have mercy or not. And in our case, with the Lord, he has mercy, but he tells us to sin no more. I'm going somewhere, bear with me. I'm not lost. When we look into Scripture, brothers and sisters, we see a God who seems to like to do. I know that we say that the number 7 is God's favorite number, and I'm down with that. But we look at a God who seems to like to do things in twos. He likes to do things in twos. He likes to do them in pairs, because God is a God who loves balance. Amen. Pastor Kevin Cable suggests that throughout Scripture, it is clear that God is a matchmaker. For instance, in Genesis 1, God paired the heaven and... Oh, come on, somebody. Then he had what? Day and... Then he had land and... Then he had sun and then he finished off with his grand design, which was man and, oh, glory be to God. He's so good, you know. He balances everything. Night and darkness, land and sea, heaven and earth, man and woman. And somebody even commented that when Jesus came into the world, he was also God's balance. How does that work, Pastor, if he was only one man? Yes, but he was fully God, and yet, Lord have mercy. However, in addition to what Pastor Cable mentions, I want to highlight another pairing that God has established, and I want you to get me. This pairing is something called mercy and truth. Mercy and truth. Allow me, if you will, to give a simple, it may not be the best example, but imagine you have a close friend who's borrowed, and it may apply to some of you, you borrowed a significant amount of money from a close friend. They wanted to borrow the money because they had an emergency bill to pay. Your friend promises to repay the loan with a specific time frame. But due to ongoing financial difficulties, the person can't pay you back, Brother Fred, when you both agreed. Amen? But you care deeply about your friend, and you understand their predicament. And in this situation, What do we talk? How do we establish mercy and truth? Well, the first thing is you forgive that person, right? Of that debt, because you love the person. And you say, okay, I get you. Life changes. And you communicate to your friend, okay, all right, okay, you owe me the money. I'm not giving you my money. I could if I wanted to, but I don't have to because we had an agreement. You owe me the money, but I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll sit down and we'll come up with another payment plan. And I'll give you a few months or maybe a year. And so far, you've shown mercy. Is that right? So where does truth come into it? Truth comes into it when you sit the friend down and you say, look here. Maybe you're spending the money in the wrong way. If you learn to handle your business better, come on, saints, you're talking truth now, huh? You're adding truth into the mix. It's not that I don't want to have mercy on you, but I want you to understand that mercy comes with truth. And I need to tell you what's gone on. There's a problem. Maybe you're spendthrift. Maybe you're a wastrel. Maybe you don't know how to handle your money. And so I tell the person out of love, and I pour mercy and truth, and both of us go away satisfied. Sarah goes to university, and I trust that none of you going to uni will ever do this. Goes to university, and they say to Sarah, write the piece on the topic that you're learning. So Sarah goes onto the computer. And she goes on to uses some chat engine, some AI, steals somebody else's writing. Come on, Sister Navon, you know what I'm talking about. Not to say that you've done it. They steal somebody else's notes off the internet and present it as their own. Whereby university teaches you that if you take a piece of work, you must do what? Cite it. In other words, you say at the bottom of the paper whose work this is. So now Sarah's been caught. Plagiarism. She's been caught red-handed. What does a teacher do? The teacher has the option of shaming her before the whole college, bringing her in before the masters and embarrassing her. But the teacher says, no, I'm going to let you off this time. But don't you dare do it again. If you're struggling, ask for help. If you're struggling, sit down and take time so that the work you present is your work. The teacher is showing mercy, but he's also showing truth. The Word of God speaks to this concept, brothers and sisters, in Psalms 85. Psalms 85 verse 8 says, I will hear what God the Lord will speak. For he will speak peace unto his people and to his saints, but let them not turn again to folly. Surely his salvation is near to them that fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. Mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Truth shall spring out of the earth, and the righteous shall look down from heaven. Righteousness shall go before him and shall set him up in his steps. This concept, brothers and sisters, of mercy and truth, sadly, is turned upside down when we read the book of John, chapter 8. This remarkable and troubling story records the account of a woman caught in adultery. Do I need to go into what that means? Perhaps not. She is caught in adultery. She is having sexual relationships as a married person with somebody else. And she is caught bare-faced, red-handed, nowhere to go. Somebody say caught. One day when Jesus is teaching in the temple, in come some Pharisees and some lawgivers, and they drag this lady in front of Jesus. And they say, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery." And they then go on to say, and they didn't lie, they say, "In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women." And then they rather rudely and cheekily look at Jesus. I can imagine them with a catty eye, their pussy eye. "What do you say?" "What do you say?" Looking to trip him up. Now, brothers and sisters, I don't know about you, but when I read the text, there are three issues that trouble me. The first thing I see is that this woman was guilty as charged. Is that right? Come on, help me, saints. She was guilty as charged. Shout it out. Guilty as charged. One more time. Guilty as charged. Whatever the situation, and however she came to be caught, she was caught red-handed and without excuse, doing something she should not have been doing. However, I have two more further questions. Did the Pharisees accidentally catch this woman in a compromising situation with this man, or was it a setup? Secondly, where was the man? Oh, I thought I might get an amen. Where was the man? You can't say he's too strong for them to handle. There was a whole heap of them. Where was the man? You see, brothers and sisters, this is a classic situation where mercy and truth have not come together. Mercy and truth have not kissed one another. When the Pharisees drag this woman to Jesus, there's a whole lot of truth going on because she is guilty, but there is an absence of mercy and any willingness to heal this situation. There is also the truth, brothers and sisters, that what they said to Jesus was true, but it was only a half-truth. Because if you read Deuteronomy, which they quoted, it said that if the man and the woman are caught in adultery, both man and woman must be stoned to death. Ooh, God. So why did they just bring the poor woman? Yes. The scribes were hoping to catch Jesus in a trap. You see, in cases of adultery, if you committed adultery, you had two different laws to deal with at the time. You had the ancient law, which I quoted in Deuteronomy, but you also had the Roman law. And if Jesus looks at the woman and releases her, he could be accused of breaking the law, the Mosaic law. He could be told that, "Jesus, well, you're supposed to be a prophet, but man, you're casual with the law. You're too loose with the law." On the other hand, if Jesus recommended stoning the woman, he would have been breaking Roman law and thus giving them another excuse for them to accuse him and to give him further trouble. The Jewish leaders cared nothing for true justice. And this is why they only brought the woman and not the man. They were guilty of showing mercy but no truth to the man, while they were guilty of showing truth but no mercy to the lady. One-sided. My friends, I always say to you, come with me. Come with me. Come with me as we stand next to this woman. There's a tension in the air. At the center of it all, there is this one solitary living woman. She's standing there all by herself. She has been sinful. She has been wicked. But she is by herself, and she is surrounded by her accusers, and she is exposed for the whole world to see. Beside her stand her accusers, the Pharisees, and in front of her stands Jesus, the Son of the living God. The crowd want to assassinate her, to murder her on the spot. She stands there. Oh God, she has no expectation that Jesus will do anything. Why would she? She's guilty. No expectation, certainly not from the Pharisees, and she has no expectation that Jesus will do anything. So she stands there and she knows in her heart that the next thing that's going to happen to me, I'm going to be dragged around the corner and they're going to stone me until I breathe my last breath. But what did Jesus do? They looked to him and they say, Jesus, what say you? What did Jesus say? The Bible said Jesus stooped down. And he started to write something on the ground. And I'm not more clever than any theologian. I don't know what he written. So don't expect me to make up anything. I could say maybe it was this, or but I can't say what he wrote. All I know is that he took his time. Oh God, I hear you, Holy Ghost. He took his time. Brother and sister, take time with people. Take time with people. Before you act, take time to consider your next step. He writes on the ground. Praise God. We don't know what he wrote on the ground. But after he finished writing, the Bible says that he stands up and he says to them, let any one of you who is without sin, go ahead. Oh, Jesus, help me this morning. Go ahead. If you have no sin, you go ahead and cast that stone. My friends, please take note of what Jesus said. He didn't say, don't stone her. No, he didn't. He never said that. He never said that you are wrong to question her behavior. Jesus said, if there's anyone among you who is that without sin, go ahead and cast that stone. And when Jesus finished speaking, and the Bible says that they which heard, oh, I love this. They which heard, being convicted by their own conscience. The Bible said that they walked away one by one, started with the oldest. Sisters and brothers, I'm glad for the Bible because I don't think I've ever saw that text before. Beginning with the eldest. And I know that this verse can mean a lot to all of you. Interpret it however you want to interpret it. But I reckon, brothers and sisters, if there's one thing that we are taught, is that big people, grown people should be the first to show mercy. Let me say that again. Grown people of age, should be the first to show mercy, because God has shown so much mercy in your life over the years that you've lived. God has been merciful to you. If there's anybody who knows the mercy of God, it's big people, it's grown people, it's people who have lived for a while. You're not gonna say amen today, but let me say it. There are some of us in church today, and those of you on the screen listening to my voice, that if it wasn't for the mercy of God, you would have died a long time ago. Man would have stabbed you. Gunman would have shot you. All kind of different thing. Bad pregnancy would have killed you. But the mercy of God has kept you till this time. Oh, God. We didn't speak the truth, but he had mercy. We tried to deceive the pastor and the family members, but God had mercy. Oh, glory be to God. You turned and backslid, but God had mercy, and he's kept you alive even till now. The car wreck, anybody remember the car wreck? Should have killed you. Come here, River, come here, quick. Come like you're coming. 3 years old, traveling home with his father. I don't know what happened to his father. Maybe it was too late in the night. His father, I don't know what happened, fell asleep. The car rolled over and rolled and rolled and rolled on the motorway, ended up in a ditch. Can't mash up. When I say mash up, mash up. And he and his dad came out alive. It is the mercy of God. If it wasn't for the mercy of God, I would not have my river. God has been merciful. And I'm old enough to remember the mercy of God. Old enough to remember his goodness. Oh, Jesus. The drugs should have left you in a coma. But God had mercy on you. Amen. He should have left you in the gutter. But God lifted you up. You remember that song? From the miry clay. Planted your feet on the King's highway. And this is the reason why we sing and we shout. Because my Jesus came down. Come on, somebody. When I didn't deserve mercy. Oh, and I know some of you look polished and shiny and clean. But we've been shown mercy by God. Had it not been. I'm going to read 26 instances in the Psalms. And I have to read it. It's going to take a few minutes, but I have to read it. And I want you to join in with me. Is that all right? Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. Oh, give thanks unto the God of gods. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord of lords. To him who does great wonders. To him that by wisdom made the heavens. To him that stretched out the earth above the waters. To him that made great lights. The sun, moon, and the stars to rule by night. The sun to rule by day. To him that smote Egypt in their firstborn. Oh, glory be to God. And brought out Israel from among them. With a strong hand and with a stretched out arm. To him which divided the Red Sea into parts. And made Israel, glory to God, to pass through the midst of it. But overthrew Pharaoh and his host in the Red Sea. To him which led his people through the wilderness. To him who smote great kings. Sihon, king of the Amorites. And Og, the king of Bashan. And gave their land for an inheritance. Even an inheritance unto the children of Israel. Who remembered us in our low estate. And has redeemed us from our enemies. Who give us food to all flesh. Oh, give thanks unto the God of heaven. Somebody praise the name of the Lord. His mercy endures forever. And after writing some more things on the ground, Jesus rises up and says, "Woman, where are thine accusers?" Oh, I love this. He said, "Has no man condemned thee?" And she says to him, "Come on, Mother Anderson. No man, Lord. Them gone." Can you imagine? 1 minute you're condemned to certain death. You're preparing your mind. You're preparing your psyche. You know that you're going to die. And then she opens her eyes and there's nobody there. But here comes truth. Jesus said, "Go, neither do I condemn you." That's the mercy. But the truth is, go, sin no more. Somebody put your hands together for our God. Jesus brings mercy and truth together. Mercy and truth kiss. The Pharisees are not interested in mercy and truth. Sometimes we are not interested in mercy and truth. Oh God, no, 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 no. Sometimes there are just some things that hang over people we're not willing to forget. But Jesus is the master of mercy and truth. And he wants his people to demonstrate mercy and truth. He is in effect saying to this woman, you did it, you know. You did it. You were caught. According to the law, you're supposed to be dead. But Jesus said, I'm going to speak mercy over your life, my God. There's somebody in here, you're hearing me, but you're troubled because you can't get past what you did. You can't get past the thing that you did in secret. It was in secret. You thought that if I leave Sheffield, I can get this thing done. I can behave how I want to behave. And you're feeling condemned. I'm here to tell you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, God's mercy is available. Oh, Lord. Brothers and sisters, sometimes mainly by the young people, you know, because they challenge me sometimes. They say, Pastor, we want sermons which speak to our everyday living, and I get that. And if there's one sermon I've preached which speaks to our everyday living, it's this one. Mercy and truth must kiss. All of us in this building must learn to show mercy and truth, because mercy was shown to you. Lord Jesus. I'm going to finish this thing with a joke. I don't know if you think it's a joke. A few months ago, I went to a meeting, an NEC meeting. Can't remember. I think it was Wales, just preparing for convention. And after 3 or 4 days in the convention, my wife doesn't know this, and I know she's going to give me a hard time now when I say this. She won't do it now, but you wait till I get home. Trust me. Trust me. Oh, thank you. Who said mercy? 4 days. I said, I need to get home now. So we got in the car. It wasn't the white car. It was my other, you know, the little sporty one. And I was halfway home. Nice, leisurely drive, you know. Listen to some music. And then I started to think about home. I started to think about what the cooking would be like, the food. Because I would be without my wife's food for a few days. I thought, I missed her, you know, only 4 days. I can't wait to be home. And then somebody made the mistake of coming behind me. Like they want to tell me to, you know, trying to test me. Now, saints, I am a work in progress, all right? I'm a work in progress. I said, not today, brother. And I put down my foot. I put down my foot. And I said, not today. And I left him for dead. Because the car is fast, you know. Little but tallower like me. Fast, you know. And I raced that car. And I left the man behind. When I got to a dual carriageway that was about 20 miles from home, I saw him coming up. I said, you can't pass me. And I put my foot down, Sister Navone. But in front of me were a whole line of cars stretching as far as I could see. And I said, I'm going to butt off every single one of them. And I put down my foot and I go, I don't know what happened to me that day. Oh, pray for me, Sister Charmaine. But I noticed that the man who challenged me had slowed down. You know where I'm going. And so I burn off every single one of them. And as I come upon the last car, and the dual carriageway was just about to run out, what did I see? A police wagon with a camera pointed at me. Oh. I put the brakes on, Sister Gabby, on, but it was too late. The big camera staring at me. I drove on towards Gloucester, because I was going to Gloucester. And I reasoned within my heart, well, I've broken the limit, and I may have to pay the fine, and I may have to go on another driver course. But at least I have the money to pay the fine. But my God, when I almost reached home, it dawned on me that if you go a certain speed over the limit, you're going to be banned. When that dawned on me, I said, my God, what is Sister Daphne going to say? And then I said, what is Sister Daisy going to say? Maybe it's a mark of respect. But I said, Lord of mercy, what Sister D is going to say? If I end up in court for a driving ban and they take away my car, what Sister D is going to say? What is the church going to say? Lord of mercy. I had to come back to Sheffield. So I said, let me change the address of the driver's license so at least it will come to Sheffield and I won't have to wait too long to know my fate. Imagine, Sister Gabilon, every morning. Every morning, you go downstairs, you're waiting for the man to deliver the mail. And then you go and you get the mail and you hide it in the back of your dressing gown because you don't know what your wife to see. Twenty-five days later. No ticket, but they give you 28 days that if they don't respond, you're free. So I go back to Gloucester with 3 days to go, and every morning I go down to the door. Is it coming? One day, something came. It was another fine. But honestly, that's something different, okay? That wasn't my fault. It was a mistake. It's when I paid to go into a hotel to park, and I paid for the weekend, but I didn't know that if you go out even for 2 minutes and come back, you'll forgive me that one, okay? But I saw the letter, Sister Angela, and I, my God, cold sweat. I said, it's fine, it's a fine, I'm gonna go to court, they're gonna shame me up, the church is gonna be embarrassed about their pastor. But it wasn't the letter I was dreading. 28 days came, no letter. I am free.
Praise God, I'm free.
What I'm saying, saints of God, is that whether I'm pastor or bishop, or any C member, or good father, or good husband, I could not go in front of the judge and play the race card. Because I was guilty, Deacon Anderson. Guilty! I deserve to be punished. And if they took away my car and my license, I couldn't do a thing. Because I was guilty. But in those 28 days, I learned something. I learned that I needed mercy. I learned that the magistrate was not going to look at my reputation. I needed mercy. And I didn't know where mercy was going to come from. But we know where our mercy comes from. Our mercy comes from God. you're here not saved, you still have time. Because His mercy endures. It is still here. We need mercy. Hallelujah. There are those of us that I'm closing who know the mistakes of others, and I know that some of you may be tired of me preaching, but I'll preach it until you're sick. I'll preach it until the bile comes out. I'll preach it until mercy and truth kiss this entire church. I'll preach it till somebody understands that had it not been for the goodness of God, I would not be who I am or where I am today. That's why you must learn to show mercy. Away with the stares. Away with the funny looks. Away with a nudge, nudge, wink, wink every time you see them come to church. Every time you say, away with that and learn to forgive, because God forgave you and God showed you mercy. Leaving none of our church brethren behind. None must be left behind. Saying to somebody the other day, if I know that you make a mistake 16 times, my job is to teach you how not to make it the 17th. But if you think there's one for 1 second that I'm going to pick you up and throw you away, it ain't going to happen. Because God showed me mercy. And He's still showing me mercy. And I wish to God that we would learn as a church, as a denomination, as a nation, as a world, to show people mercy. If you want to know, and I'm closing, who I care about, I'm the kind of pastor I don't really. I guess it's a 99 mentality, isn't it? Where Jesus leaves the 99, and He goes looking for that one. That's how I feel as a pastor. There's some of you that are so together, if you want to use that word. But there are others struggling. And brethren, I don't want to hear from nobody. Nobody. If you want to upset me and make me mad, get me angry, you criticize one of the brethren in front of me. Guaranteed to rail me up. Because every day I wake, I remember the goodness of God. This lady wrote this song, "All My Life, He Has Been Faithful." All my life, You have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, hallelujah. So, brethren, as your pastor, I can't take the brethren being abused. I don't like it. If I know about it, I'll deal with it with mercy and with truth, but no, it's not for me. Because I've been shown mercy. And I've been shown mercy by my brethren. And I've been shown mercy by my pastors. And I've been shown mercy by people who could have buried me. But they showed mercy. And whether whatever I'm good at, whatever I'm weak at, whatever the strength of my life is, I want to be a person who knows how to show mercy and truth. If you fail, I'm going to correct you, but I ain't going to reject you. This is the kind of church I want to be a pastor of. This is the kind of church I want to be. This is the kind of church that will make me proud to be here. A church that knows how to deliver mercy, because mercy was shown to you. Now, to all of you who love judgment, you're going to find yourself left behind. Little by little, you're going to find yourself left behind until one of these days when the trump of God shall sound and He shall say to me, "Get away from me, I never knew you." There's too much judgment in our world. Too much condemnation in our church. I'm here to let you know that if you fail, any one of you, I'm here for you.
interested in judgment. Not interested. Not interested. I don't care what anybody says. I'm here for you. I'll back you to the hilt. Because God is a God of mercy. Mercy there was great. Grace was free. Pardon was multiplied. Oh my God. Multiplied to me. It was there. My burdened soul found liberty. The Calvary. Mercy and truth have kissed. May we learn to show mercy today. In the name of the Lord. Stand with me, please. I love you, Lord. Sandra, you can sing it better than me. You can even raise it better than me. Huh? Go ahead, my darling. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's sing.
I love you, Lord.
Think, saints, think.
For your mercy never fails me.
Go and give that mercy to somebody else.
Day,
glory.
I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head,
I will sing
of the goodness of God.
One more time.
I love you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
For your mercy never fail me. All my days I've been held in your hands.
Hallelujah.
From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will see of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so
life, all my life. Just one more time. Oh, my life you have been faithful.
Oh, my life you have been faithful.
Every day of my life, my life, my life.
Oh, my life you have been
so good.
So good.
going to ask you to pray. And I'm going to ask you to pray, saints, that this church will be a church of refuge. We're not advocating lawlessness, because lawlessness and sin will always be dealt with from the pulpit. I'm not going anywhere with regard lawlessness and sin, but I want this place to be a place of recovery. I want this place to be a place where guilty women who need stoning come and they are released by God's mercy. I want this to be a place where broken men come and they are released by God's mercy. This is what church is, you see. I know, Sheffield, that we have had a historic past. There have been lots of things happened. But I hear God say, show mercy. What's done is done. Because all my life, you see, He has been faithful. All my life He has been so, so good. With every breath I'm able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Let's pray that this place will be a house of mercy. Let us pray, saints. Let us pray. A house of mercy, Lord. A house where people can recover. A house where people can stumble and fall and still be themselves. A house where there's a room of recovery in every room, instruments of recovery. A house where there are blankets. A house where there's medicine. A house.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Where there are tablets. A house where there are clean sheets. A house where there's food to eat. A house where there is shelter. A house where every ward is fully kitted for whoever might come. And I pray for the doctors and the nurses of this house, that we may administer peace to every wound and mercy to every wound. Yes, we may have to show some people their wrongs, and we don't stand for ungodliness, we don't stand for unrighteousness, and we want to correct some things. But let mercy and truth kiss in this church. May the lips of mercy and the lips of truth come together so tightly that nothing can come in between. Let this house be a house where the love of God is known and seen and felt, if only for your mercy that you have shown us in our lives. I'd like to say thank you for the example that you gave us today. Thank you for that woman who was able to go home. I don't know how she lived after that. We don't know. Don't know what she did. But she will never wake another day and know that God didn't show her mercy. I pray for the relationships in this church and in families, that we will come together as God's people. Let those bygones go. Let them go. They haven't helped us anyway. Don't want to carry them, Lord. We want to show mercy so that every child can grow. None will be left behind. So we thank you, Lord, for every car crash. We thank you for every druggie. We thank you for everyone who left the church. We thank you for everyone who backslid. We thank you for every careless soul, because you showed them mercy. And I love you for that, God. I really do. I think you're amazing. I think you're wonderful, Father. And I want to praise your holy name. Is there a young person that would like to come to the altar and just shout out, thank God for mercy and for grace? Come on, two young people. We've all benefited from it. I want two young people up to the age of 16, come to the front and just say, thank God for mercy and your grace. Come on, I know you want to come. I'm not even going to look at anybody. I know you want to come. 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 Come and shout it out, baby. Thank God. Shout it, sweetheart. Thank God.
I thank God for mercy and grace.
Amen.
I thank God for mercy and grace.
Hallelujah. Amen. I want some 20-somethings now to come. If we don't have them, let's have some 30-something, 20-something. Oh, come on. Here's a 20-something. Come. Shout out, thank God for mercy and grace. Amen. Somebody say amen.
I'd just like to thank the Lord for showing me mercy all this time. Without him, I won't be here. All glory to God.
Amen. Amen. Let me have a 30-something come and say, thank God for mercy and grace. No, not Deacon Anderson. Let's have a 40-something that would, somebody 40-odd would come and say, thank God for mercy and grace.
Thank God for mercy and grace.
Amen. 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 Let me have somebody in their 50s come and say, thank God. And say it like you mean it. Come, Gary. Come, come, my sister. Come. Amen. Amen.
Thank God for mercy and grace.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Thank
Amen.
You, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank God for mercy and grace.
Hallelujah. Somebody in your 60s, all my life, he has been faithful. Come on. Glory be to God.
Thank God for mercy and grace. If it wasn't for the grace of God, I wouldn't be standing here today.
Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
I just want to give God. Praise for his mercy and his ever-loving grace.
Hallelujah. Thank
Bless
you,
the
Lord.
Lord.
Praise God. Praise God.
I want to give God thanks for his mercy and his grace. The Lord has brought me from a mighty, mighty long way. Praise and glory be to God.
Hallelujah. Come on, 70s, 60s and 70s, come. Look, they're coming, they're coming, they're coming. They recognize the goodness of God. I would have fainted if I had not believed, come on, darling, to see, amen. Bridget, the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Go ahead, sis.
Brethren, the Lord is so good to me. From 2019, I don't have a fridge or a washing machine. And that damn Sunday when Pastor called, a sister take me to Curry's and say I have to choose a washing machine. And I thank God I get rid of the fridge as well, but I don't want any fridge yet, for I can't afford the electric.
Look where God has brought me from. A mighty, mighty, mighty long way. Only by his grace, his mercy, and his love.
God for his mercy and grace. We live because he lives. He is our anchor, delivering us from every situation we find ourselves in. And we praise him, and we love him and adore him.
Thank God for his mercy and love. I will praise the Lord with my soul. Thank God, and I will worship him always. Thank God.
Amen.
Shall we praise the Lord? Praise the Lord. I'm not in my 70s, I'm in my 60s. And I give God thanks because I'm 64 January gone. To God be the glory. Great things have done for me, because if it wasn't for grace and mercy, I would not be here. Thank God.
Amen.
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be my mouth. I want to worship the Lord with all of my heart. Yes, God has been good. His mercies are everlasting. His truth will endure forever. I'm thanking God for his grace and his mercies.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
I'm thanking the Lord for his mercy and grace to save a wretched sinner like me. The Lord is good. No, I was down, going down, down, down. But the Lord grabbed me up and put me on solid ground. Praise the Lord.
Thank God for his mercy and grace. If it's never God, I wouldn't stand in here today. I should dead and gone a long time. But because his grace, hallelujah. Because his grace and his mercy, hallelujah. Hallelujah. That keep me on this rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sound. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Last one.
Thank God for mercy and grace.
Amen. I'm going to finish it off with one more river. You nearly died. You nearly died. God was good to you. I want you to tell the church, thank God for his mercy. Turn around and face the church.
Thank God for his mercy and grace.
Amen. Amen. So now to God I commit you. And to God I commend you, but grow in grace. And in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be all glory, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Go in grace and in his mercy. In Jesus' name. Amen.